Welcome to another episode of An Offer You Can't Refuse. I'm your host, Ryan S. Pattengill, and today's episode is entitled A Sucker's Paradise, Meyer Lansky and the Making of the Havana Mob. You know that scene in The Godfather 2 when Hyman Roth is holding court with those gangsters atop a roof in a fancy Cuban hotel? Of course you do. I mean, you're listening to this podcast. But there's a part in that dialogue when they're cutting the cake where Roth says, quote, "This kind of government knows how to help business, how to encourage it. The hotels here are bigger and swankier than any of the rug joints we put in Vegas. We can thank our friends in the Cuban government," end quote. There's an enormous amount of historical accuracy to that statement, but like anything else that we've taken up in this series, it's coming as a part of a broader context, and for the purposes here today, that context is American imperialism. In the aftermath of the Spanish-American War, the United States would emerge as the preeminent power in the Western Hemisphere. For all of our talk about liberating Cuba from the evil Spanish, we basically replaced them as the ruling regime, not only in Cuba, but really throughout the entirety of the Caribbean and Central America. Some of you may be familiar with how American political dominance allowed big corporations like the United Fruit Company to pillage the Cuban economy, and how that pillaging ultimately helped pave the way for the rise of Fidel Castro. Some of you may even be familiar with what came to be known as the Havana Conference, a meeting of the minds, so to speak, which was parodied in that scene from The Godfather. The mob had much business to sort out. Everything ranging from getting Lucky Luciano back on his feet to what to do about Benny Siegel and what was going on with the Flamingo back in Vegas. Whatever the business, none of this would have been possible without an American-friendly Cuban government firmly in place. And that's where Fulgencio Batista came in. So let's talk. I was looking at some of the analytics for this series the other day, and suffice to say, it's a safe bet to say that the vast majority of this audience is old enough to remember the Dream Team, the 1992 men's Olympic basketball team who went on to win the gold medal, beating opponents by an average of 50 points per game. And if you don't know who the Dream Team was, ask your parents, or maybe your grandparents. Anyway, the Michael Jordans, Karl Malones, and Larry Birds of the criminal underworld were Charlie Luciano, Albert Anastasia, and Meyer Lansky. These guys had perfected their craft in the days of Prohibition, and by the late 1940s had amassed their wealth into a vast criminal empire spanning throughout the United States. And in the post-war period, they were looking to take their operation to the next level. Through 1940, the mob had done a superb job of greasing the political wheels to accommodate the vice that made them millionaires. But at the end of the day, those vices were still illegal. If you're a regular on this program, you know why mobsters like Benny Siegel coveted Las Vegas so much. It offered a legal solution to vice in the form of gambling. Of course, the occasional politician or local official needed to be persuaded to go along with everything, but for the most part, they were making money on the things that were criminal in other parts of the country, and they were doing so out in broad daylight. I don't know if you could say that Vegas whetted the mob's appetite, but figures like Meyer Lansky had long dreamed of a national entity where vice was legal and free from governmental interference. What they came up with was Cuba. What Luciano, Lansky, and Tampa's Santo Traficante envisioned was a criminal empire, of which Cuba would serve as the capital. In this criminal state, the entirety of the rackets, union pensions, public utilities, banking, prostitutions, and so much more were not only legal, but they were controlled by the mob. And the mob could funnel the money that it was bringing in throughout the United States into these offshore Cuban bank accounts. By the late 1940s, the stars began to align and the vision began to take shape. It is possible that Lansky and Luciano had envisioned a national crime state much earlier than the post-war period. Some posit that it may go back as far as the 1920s, and they weren't alone. It was said that Al Capone also eyed the island nation of Cuba as a place where they could conduct his business without fear of interference from the American government. And these ambitions went a lot further than gambling. Public employees, pensions, national utilities, banks and other financial institutions, entertainment broadly defined, tourism, or any conceivable industry would be controlled by the mob. Not only that, but they could stash their profits in these offshore banks and thereby avoid paying income taxes and in the process dodge the bullet that took down, most famously, Capone and eventually other gangsters. But for any of this to be possible, the mob would need a friend in Havana, who they found was one of the most brutal dictators in human history, Fulgencio Batista. Batista imposed a military dictatorship in 1952 and over the course of the next several years allowed the American mafia to build an empire in Cuba. There are scholars that argue that this is impossible to understand, this modern-day relationship that the United States has with Cuba, without at least taking into consideration the events that took shape in the 1950s and involved the mob. And I think they're right. But for any of this to make sense, I need to take you back about 50 years, right about the time that America was becoming an imperial nation. Manifest destiny was the concept that was being thrown around in the United States throughout the mid-19th century. It drove at this idea that it was the American God-given destiny to create a sea-to-sea empire. And with the end of the U.S.-Mexican War in 1848, Manifest destiny had been achieved. The Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo forced Mexico to cede a third of a continent. California, Arizona, New Mexico, Utah, Nevada, and a chunk of Colorado were all part of this exchange. For most of the rest of the 19th century, the philosophy of isolationism would return and dominate American foreign policy. For the most part, we minded our own business and expected European countries to stay out of ours. But by the late 1890s, things had changed. The American economy had surpassed the British as the largest industrial economy on the planet, and there was real concern that production would outpace consumption. Overseas markets took on a whole new level of importance. Around the same time, Alfred T. Mahan, a captain in the American Navy, published The Influence of Sea Power Upon History. The long book argued that all great nations had one thing in common, a top-notch navy. Mahan argued that it was imperative that America modernize its navy to keep up with the other great powers of the world. And he went further to point out that by modernizing our navy, we could control the flow of goods and money, which would most definitely benefit our economy. It was sort of like the form of imperialism the British had sponsored a generation earlier, but with modern nuances. Mahan pointed out that you didn't have to control all of Africa to drain the region of its value. The British, in fact, did not control all of Africa, but they did control the Suez Canal, a man-made river that connected the Red Sea with the Mediterranean, and drained the region of its value in the process. Why couldn't America do the same thing in the Western Hemisphere? He took it a step further, pointing out that American producers were at a distant disadvantage when it came to tapping into the lucrative China market, considering they had to sail around South America and then across the Pacific to get their wares to market. He noted that a superhighway system right in the middle of Central America would shorten that time and in the process allow the U.S. to get a taste of anyone doing business in that region. Of course, what I'm talking about is the Panama Canal. In the end, Mahan's lobbying paid off. By 1898, the American Navy climbed from 13th in the world, right above Bulgaria, to number 3. We had a new and modern fleet, but what to do with it? William Randolph Hearst was the Rupert Murdoch of his day, a media mogul who owned dozens of newspapers and periodicals throughout the country. In 1895, Hearst bought the New York Journal, a paper that was failing, but he hoped would compete with Joseph Pulitzer's New York World. In an attempt to breathe new life back into the paper and sell copies, Hearst launched what came to be known as yellow journalism. Yellow journalism was very similar to the muckraking journalism we were talking about on this series back in the Gilded Age. But instead of sensationalized stories about the meatpacking industry, these articles featured horror stories about what was happening abroad. What Hearst journalists found was Cuba. Cuba was the colonial holding of Spain, a crumbling imperial power that was a shadow of what it had been when Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Throughout the 1890s, the Cubans began rebelling against their Spanish colonizers. To be clear, this was not your grandfather's Spain, but to the Cubans, who were pushing for their independence, they were still very much a superpower. And what do you do when you're fighting an enemy with superior technology, manpower, and money? Is you fight them on the cheap. You engage in guerrilla warfare, sneak attacks, ambushes, and acts of sabotage. There's no overwhelming victory in battle, just a slow but steady trickle of blood back to Madrid, giving the superpower fits and demoralizing the citizenry back at home. So the Cubans had been fighting a guerrilla war, and while they still had a long way to go, it was showing some effective signs by 1898. To counter the guerrillas, the Spanish began implementing a process of reconcentration. Because they couldn't tell a friendly Cuban from an unfriendly Cuban, they rounded everyone up in the countryside and concentrated them in the cities, Santiago, Havana, etc. If this sounds a little bit like concentration camps, it's because they were concentration camps. And anywhere you have concentration camps, you have atrocities. I can hear you asking, what does this have to do with the United States, let alone organized crime? Well, Hearst sent his journalists into Cuba to interview these freedom fighters. They didn't really care about the stories that would eventually grace the headlines of the New York Journal were biased, and in a lot of instances, factually suspect. They only cared about selling newspapers. And when it came to that, they had done a fantastic job. And as Americans from all over the country read these newspapers, they were appalled by the Spanish atrocities. And their outrage prompted them to call their congressmen and demand the U.S. do something. The guy who was running the country in 1898 was William McKinley, a veteran of the Civil War who knew what war looked like, so he wasn't really so gung-ho when it came to American intervention. His assistant secretary of the Navy, Theodore Roosevelt, not a veteran himself, felt that the U.S. needed a war, and what was shaping up 90 miles off the coast of Florida was the best one on option, so we should take that opportunity. With public opinion running high on war fever, McKinley tried to deflect calls for intervention by sending a battleship named the USS Maine to Havana's harbor to impress upon the Spanish how seriously we took what was going on in Cuba. Well, the Maine hadn't been there very long when it mysteriously blew up. In the minds of millions of Americans, this was clearly the work of the evil Spanish. The moniker, "Remember the Maine, to hell with Spain," became the American rallying cry, and McKinley was out of options. He had to declare war. The war with Spain was short, cheap in terms of lives, and incredibly decisive. The Spanish fleet was sunk, Teddy Roosevelt and his Rough Riders charged up San Juan Hill, and Spain surrendered in less than 2 weeks. The Treaty of Paris, signed in 1899, ceded Spanish territories to the United States, making America both a colonial and world power by the dawn of the 20th century. In 1897, the Spanish controlled the Philippines off the coast of mainland Asia, Guam in the Central Pacific, and Puerto Rico in the Caribbean Sea. Each of these colonies became American territories in the aftermath of the Spanish-American War. The great irony was that this war began and ended due to Spanish crimes in Cuba, but Cuba was the one colony the U.S. did not take. The question becomes, why? It turns out the U.S. could have had its cake and eat it too. The Secretary of State Orville Platt issued a proclamation that came to be known as the Platt Amendment in 1901. Similar to the Monroe Doctrine from a generation earlier, the Platt Amendment proffered an end to European colonization in the Caribbean, in this case, Cuba. It also said that the U.S. would basically look out for the island nation. Now, by look out, I mean intervene. The Platt Amendment noted that the U.S. would have the authority to intervene in Cuban affairs whenever it deemed necessary. Riots in Santiago? We can send in the troops. The Cuban economy collapses? We can take over their banks. It's Wednesday, and TR can't find his shoes. You get the idea. We basically controlled Cuba, a strategically central point in the Caribbean, without the burden of governing Cuba. And that meant picking and choosing its political, economic, and military leaders. In short, that's how Cuba got Fulgencio Batista. He was warm to American geopolitical interests, allowing fat cat corporations like the United Fruit Company to pillage the Cuban economy. And without Batista, the mafia's vision of a state-sponsored criminal empire would have been a silly daydream. Again, it wasn't lost on other gangsters what kind of potential Cuba held when it came to illegal enterprises. During the heyday of Prohibition, the price of sugar doubled, and Cuba was a major exporter of this cash crop. But it didn't just end there. Industry, broadly defined, was on the rise throughout the island nation. There was also gambling. The Grand Casino Nacional was one of the most opulent gaming establishments anywhere in the Americas, and the racetrack, where tourists could bet on the horses, was within shouting distance. It was also the seedier side of the business that was Cuba. What was coming to be known as the quote-unquote pleasure trust was basically the sex trade, which began to thrive in Cuba as early as the 1920s. While others dreamed of what Cuba could be, it was Meyer Lansky that was willing to play the long game. He clearly saw the bonanza that was Prohibition. It would end soon, and the mob would need to take the proceeds that came their way throughout the Jazz Age and deploy them as seed money for the next great criminal enterprise. I mean, what better endeavor than a national government ran for gangsters? Lansky could envision a day when the mafia would finance, build, and operate new casino hotels without the supervision of the American government. And it hardly stopped there. He envisioned restaurants, nightclubs, and bars, all of which were controlled by the mob. Banks and financial institutions could not only launder the mob's money, but could hold it for safekeeping, completely out of the reach of the federal government. But for any of this to happen, Lansky was going to need a man in Havana. And that's where Batista came in. Lansky could see Batista had potential, and he courted him from a very early point in the young man's military career. The hope was, One day, Batista would serve not only as the political wing of the Mafia's operation in Cuba, but also its enforcement mechanism. In 1933, he took the idea to his partner, Charlie Luciano, who had yet to be indicted by Thomas Dewey. Luciano loved the idea, actually going so far as to push it as a national mafia campaign, hand-selecting mob chiefs from all around the country. As part of his courtship, Lansky had bought a small share in one of the jewels of Cuba's tourist industry, Havana's Hotel Nacional. By the mid-1930s, he had established a front organization called the Cuban National Corporation, which soon thereafter merged with the National Cuba Hotel Corporation, a fledgling corporate organization that would eventually evolve into a branch of the Hilton Hotel chain. Lansky was not only paving the way for future inroads into the Cuban economy, but also a level of corporate legitimacy that would accompany it. By 1937, Lansky moved his operation from New York to Southern Florida, operating out of a small office on Flagler Street in Miami. Meanwhile, Luciano went about his selection of fellow bosses that would eventually come to be known as the Havana Mob. Naturally, there was Frank Costello, but he also tapped Longy Zwillman to sit on the board. New Orleans's Carlo Morcello and Tampa's Santo Trafficante were also board members. By this point, Lansky and his associates were experts, so to speak, when it came to running casinos. They'd been running them, albeit illegally, since the 1920s. The mob had a huge network of dealers, croupiers, pit bosses, and floor managers that were not only experienced, but they could be trusted by the mob. By 1937, Fulgencio Batista was unquestionably using the Cuban military to control the nation, and that was the mob's big break. So when that break came, Lansky was ready. Batista invited him to Havana for a meeting to execute the plan that the two men had been perfecting since 1928. Lansky brought his casino, quote-unquote, employees, along with him. It was the winter of 1937, the beginning of the tourist season. Lansky brought some innovations with him, along with his people. As the 1939 racing season was set to begin, he launched an idea that would come to be known as the Golden Ticket. A golden ticket was handed out as special ceremony to select gamblers, giving them access to exclusive bets, private game rooms, and a premier treatment at many of Havana's most opulent clubs. Lansky's boat, it seemed, had come in. And then the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor and it was all over. Well, maybe that's a little bit too far to take it. Maybe it's fairer to say that everything was paused. If you are a regular on this series, you know Charlie Luciano was convicted of running a prostitution ring by the time that the war came. You also know that his cooperation with U.S. Naval Intelligence convinced the now Governor Thomas Dewey to commute that sentence, with one key wrinkle. Luciano was deported to Sicily. Luciano was a big deal in Sicily, but he had long considered the U.S. to be his home, and he very much sought a way to come back to his homeland. And it was here that Cuba offered an avenue back home. No one knew how badly Luciano wanted to come back, better than Lansky. And Lansky also wanted to take the opportunity of the post-war period to reboot his Cuba operation. Finally, by 1946, there were big decisions that the mafia needed to make with respect to how to proceed, you know, in places like Las Vegas. Now, technically, Lansky didn't have the authority to call a national meeting because he wasn't Italian. So, technically, it was Luciano that called the meeting of the mines in Havana in 1946. Now, this meeting was very similar to the one in 1929 in Atlantic City. It was a lot of decisions that had to be made, and a lot of those decisions had everything to do with what to do with one of their own. By the time that this meeting was called, there were major threats that were posed to the longevity of the overall operation. If you think back to the Atlantic City Conference in 1929, All these decisions kind of revolved around Al Capone, but in 1946, it was Benny Siegel, Lansky's childhood friend, longtime associate, and representative in Las Vegas. By 1946, Siegel's Flamingo Hotel was hemorrhaging money, and many bosses accused Siegel of skimming money, and some wanted him dead. It's not exactly entirely clear who gave the actual order, but it is commonly assumed that Luciano gave Lansky an ultimatum. Siegel had to go. 6 months later, Benny Siegel lay dead in the living room of Virginia Hills' Beverly Hills home. While who gave the actual order may be lost to history, it is pretty clear that the decision to eliminate Siegel was made at the Hotel Nacional at what would later become known as the Havana Conference. The Havana Conference may be one of the most important events in the history of organized crime. Mobsters came from far and wide. Cleveland, Atlantic City, Detroit, Newark, New Orleans, Tampa, and of course, New York and Chicago. Most of those in attendance had long since had formal ties to Luciano and the syndicate. Fito Genovese, Albert Anastasia, Frank Costello, Tampa's Santo Traficante, and New Orleans' very own Carlo Marcello. But there were others too, non-Italians, non-made men who wielded an enormous amount of power. Cleveland's Mo Dalitz, New Jersey's Doc Stacker, and Longy's Willman. This was truly a meeting of the minds, the who's who of the underworld. So Lansky must have had something big in mind when he came to the agenda for this meeting. There was so much to discuss in Havana. A big part of the agenda was to figure out a way to get Luciano back on his feet, at least within the Western Hemisphere. Quote-unquote delegates of this conference were encouraged to pay homage to the capo, and they arrived with envelopes full of cash, a tribute of sorts. Frank Sinatra arrived with the Fischetti brothers with a suitcase full of cash. In the end, Lucky took in upwards of $150,000, of which he turned around and gave to Lansky to be invested in the Hotel Nacional. Now, Lansky, for his part, had other things to propose. He outlined what he hoped would become the epicenter of gambling, Cuba. He suggested that acres and acres of land be bought throughout the island, and he pushed the envelope even further, arguing that the Isle of Pine, a small nearby island that was presently being used as a penal colony, it'd be purchased and developed into a gaming center similar to California's Monte Carlo, complete with a private airport and massive hotel casino. Lansky also wanted to discuss the matter of narcotics. Despite what we all saw in The Godfather, the mob saw the massive profit potential of drugs, heroin, cocaine, and marijuana, and the potential that they had to outpace even the boom times of prohibition and alcohol, if it was done right. This was tricky in the U.S., as the Justice Department had an entire division, headed by the much-feared Harry J. Anslinger, dedicated to nailing drug traffickers. Luciano, considering his first incarceration had been on drug charges, was especially squeamish when it came to narcotics. But Cuba, 90 miles off the coast of Florida, was beyond Anslinger's control, his reach. At the same time, its climate and the climate of neighboring countries was ideal when it came to the cultivation of these quote-unquote cash crops. Lastly, the logistics offered by Cuba blew the doors off the French Connection, a Sicilian-dominated opium trade grounded in the sometimes French, sometimes Italian island of Corsicana, just north of Sicily in the middle of the Mediterranean. Lansky, and to a much greater extent, Luciano, protested, but to no avail. The group was firmly behind jumping into narcotics. And then there was the business that was Frank Sinatra. By 1946, Sinatra's career was on the rocks, and he was in desperate need of cash to reinvent himself. Considering he was still a star, albeit a fading one, it was easier for him to move around from airport to airport than the average Joe. So Sinatra, from time to time, was known to act as a cash courier of sorts for the mafia. He showed up in Havana with the Fischetti brothers and a suitcase full of $2 million, well over $16 million in 21st century currency. For years, Sinatra had denied even knowing Lucky, but when the FBI archives opened up and Frank was photographed with his arm slung around Luciano, it was kind of hard to deny. But it worked out for Sinatra in the long run. Luciano is said to have personally green-lighted the capital Frank so desperately needed to get his career back on track. The Mafia and the Havana Conference essentially saved his career. But above all, the agenda revolved around Lansky's vision to transform Cuba into a national crime state where any vice was legal, and instead of buying off the state so law enforcement would look the other way, the quote-unquote state was an open and willing partner with the vice lords who stood to make millions. It's important to note that all of this business, the Havana Conference, all of this political machinations within the mafia, it's all taking place at a time when Fulgencio Batista was not in power. I'm not sure if there's a Cuban variety to the concept of the American dream, but if there is, certainly Batista is its definition. Fulgencio Batista had working class roots. His father cut sugarcane in the island sugar fields. After giving up on school, Batista joined his father as a cutter, but at the age of 21, frustrated with working harder and harder for less and less, he enlisted in the Cuban military and set his sights on becoming a stenographer. Much like the U.S., the military was a key institution that lent itself to upward mobility in Cuban life. But in Cuba, it was so much more than that. It was the cornerstone of social control in the nation. Oftentimes, elections were determined by a core elite group of Cuban officers, usually choosing one that curried their favor the most. The fleecing of public funds was basically to be expected from government officials, regardless of their political philosophy. It went all the way back to 1899 when Cuba was officially, quote-unquote, liberated. By embarking on a career in the military, Batista got an up-close and personal look at this quid pro quo corruption in Cuban political life. His advanced understanding of how to give and take political favors most likely explains why he got along real well with Meyer Lansky, who had been doing this in the U.S. for decades. Batista had risen to the rank of a sergeant by the time that he was in his early 30s. He was also coming of age in a very opportunistic time in Cuban history. Gerardo Machado was a brutal Cuban dictator who had, in 1933, inspired a political revolt which trickled down into the military. Later that year, Machado abdicated power and fled the country, thus opening the door to leadership in Cuba. Meanwhile, Batista had committed himself to studying oratory, and by 1933, he was a skilled public speaker. He was also a devout fan of José Martí, a great Cuban leader and populist who had supported Cuban independence a generation earlier. Given these circumstances, Batista was perfectly positioned to take advantage of the power vacuum in Cuba, which is exactly what he did in 1933 in what came to be known as the Revolt of the Sergeants, installing himself as leader of the Cuban military. At the age of 32, he was the most powerful man in all of Cuba, controlling the nation through a series of puppet presidents. He would control the nation for the next 8 years when, in 1940, he was elected president and suspended the Cuban Constitution. In 1933, Lansky's original plan was to have Batista lead the development of a major casino gambling empire in Cuba, but it was interrupted. First by political instability, then by the Great Depression, then by a world war. For more than a decade, Cuba's tourist economy had laid dormant. Lansky was determined to bring it back. According to fellow mobster Doc Stacker, Lansky presented Batista with three suitcases full of cash, $1 million to be exact, and Lansky essentially made an investment in Batista. Lansky also promised $3 to $5 million per year in the way of a guarantee from the casinos Meyer wanted to plant in Havana. From 1933 to 1940, Batista implemented a reign of terror, although he himself considered himself to be a benevolent dictator. He was said to have made millions of dollars in the country's legal gambling ventures, but then, in 1944, for reasons that are not entirely clear, he went into retirement. But before he left, he put his replacement forward. But that replacement, turns out, lost the election, and El Presidente was forced into exile. Batista's lifestyle did not exactly take a hit while he was out of power, and while his endeavors in Vegas, New York, and South Florida were firmly in place, Lansky wasn't making much progress on the Cuban front. A huge part of the agenda for the Havana Conference was mobilizing national support for his vision for what Cuba could become. Lansky's vision for Cuba was simply impossible without his man Batista in the picture. In the end, the Havana Conference was a signal that the impressive collection of gangsters that Lansky had assembled, they were ready to go. Investment was in place, and Capos had been given orders. It was a mere matter of months after the Havana Conference when Lansky reached out to the exiled leader and told him he was needed back in Cuba. Everything was in place to execute their plan that had been hatched all the way back to the Great Depression. To be sure, this involved Batista staging a political comeback, which, with his years in exile, was not going to be easy. Batista's return isn't going to make anyone interested in democracy especially happy. He started by running for and winning a seat in the Senate. In 1951, he took the next step and he ran for president, but just weeks before the scheduled election, it was obvious to anyone paying attention that he had lost his popularity. He was polling a distant third. But Batista had one card left to play, and that, of course, was the military. He led a military coup against President Carlo Prio right before the election, and he installed himself as president. Batista was back, and for Lansky, it seemed his ship had come in again, at least for the moment. Meyer Lansky was not in a great place in 1950. The Kefauver hearings had done a real number on his interest in Miami. Like every other mob stronghold in the nation, Lansky had been buying off the cops for years. The Kefauver hearings exposed all this, and as a result, his clubs in Miami were raided and shut down. The news of Batista's return was most definitely welcome news for a scenario that otherwise looked pretty grim. Charlie Luciano was not as lucky. What initially seemed to be a blip on the radar, the concept of Cuba, as we'll see in the series, was synonymous with sex. And this was evidenced from the earliest of points at the Havana Conference. Frank Sinatra was not remiss to partake in some of the extracurricular activities once his official duties as a courier were complete. Long story short, both he and Luciano were caught up in this sex scandal that managed to leak out of the island and caught on in several U.S. newspapers, thereby alerting the attention of the Bureau of Narcotics and Harry Anslinger. We've discussed Anslinger in this series before, and bear in mind this was not his first go-around with Luciano. Lucky had been busted, once upon a time, on narcotics charges. The sex scandal put a massive spotlight on the fact that Lucky was back in the Western Hemisphere, just 90 miles off of American shores. Anslinger alerted the State Department, which formally demanded that the Cuban government deport Luciano back to Italy. For their part, the Cubans pushed back, stating that Luciano's passport was in good order and he hadn't, to the best of their knowledge, been involved in anything illegal. It was at that point that Anslinger turned to President Truman. Harry Truman responded by threatening to cut off all U.S. medical drugs to Cuba unless Luciano was ousted. So again, we see the uneven balance of power between Cuba and the United States. So much for all the planning and organizing to get Luciano back in the mix. Lucky was out. But for Lansky, this had a silver lining. There had always been a certain level of baggage that accompanied Luciano. He was smart enough and tough enough and all that, but he had been busted for drugs once already, and it was his idea to get involved in the prostitution trade that ultimately led to his first deportment. With Lucky out of the way, Lansky was clearly in the driver's seat. It's impossible to get everything that was Cuba when it comes to the role that the mob played, at least in one episode. There's a reason I'm planning to build this into another miniseries, but for now, let's talk about what Cuba was going to become for the mafia, at least on a very basic level. It would be the hotel casinos that would prove to be the crown jewel when it came to the business that was Cuba. Foremost amongst these were the Hotel Nacional, which Meyer Lansky would play a huge role in both running and refurbishing. And once it was complete, it offered luxury, ambiances, as well as entertainment. Much like the Sands, it was the place to see and be seen with celebs. There was also the Hotel Capri Casino, of which Lansky also played a central role. The outfits Sam Giancana also held significant influence in the Capri, which opened much later, in 1957. But like the Hotel Nacional, it was known for its opulent accommodations, access to celebrities, as well as its discretion when it came to activities that approached the gray area of legality. Santo Trafficante Jr. was another mafioso whose influence was pervasive throughout Cuba. Trafficante held an interest in the Tropicana Club, the Sanssouci Club, the Riviera Hotel and Casino, and the Hotel Sevilla Biltmore, as well as the Hotel Davao Casino. The Hilton Hotel in Havana during the 1950s embodied the luxury and glamour of the era. As fate would have it, it played a central role in the crises within the mafia that would take shape in 1959, a crisis with Albert Anastasia at its center. Although there were several figures within the American underworld that held sway in Cuba throughout the 1950s, the two big players were Lansky and Trafficante, but it wasn't lost on people like New York's Anastasia, the one-time member of Murder, Inc., with the notorious nickname Lord High Executioner, that people were making millions off the island. He wanted in. Actually, he more or less accused Lansky of hoarding Cuba for his own purposes. In the end, Lansky capitulated and offered the Hilton to Anastasia, but Albert didn't have much time to enjoy it. He was assassinated at the Park Sheridan Hotel in Midtown in the fall of 1957. His strewn body, covered with a white sheet with blood flowing freely throughout the crime scene, made national headlines and put organized crime squarely on the spotlight when it came to the public's attention. It would lead to the Appalachia Conference, a mafia summit of sorts. For now, let's understand that Cuba, in the 1950s, represented everything that Lansky hoped the mafia could become. A global enterprise that functioned outside the jurisdiction of the U.S. State Department and whose influence extended far beyond the traditional rackets associated with organized crime heretofore. The little man, as Lansky was sometimes known, went all in. Unfortunately for him, so too did an emerging political star who was coming of age around the same time Fulgencio Batista was coming back to power. Fidel Castro saw the gangsterism on full display throughout this era for what it was. It was another example of a foreign power controlling the island nation, an issue that had plagued the Cuban people for more than a century. Although Batista saw potential in him and actually attempted to co-opt him at one point, no one really took Castro serious in these early days. His message of nationalism, which frequently took the form of Marxist populism, was not exactly hitting close to home for many Cubans. It would take another 8 or 9 years for the corruption of the Batista regime to catch up with the mob. But when it did, Castro emerged as the new leader of the Cuban people, and the little man came up empty. 1953, the Saturday Evening Post ran a story entitled Suckers in Paradise, How Americans Lose Their Shirts in Caribbean Gambling Joints. The American media had caught on to the action off its southern coast. The making of the Havana Mob is a fascinating story in its own right, and I'm sure you can see why it's worthy of its own miniseries. More immediately, I'm hopeful that you're able to see that the Havana Conference would have been all but impossible had it not been for the events that took place throughout the Caribbean earlier on in the 20th century. But for now, we need to roll some credits. For an incredibly thorough overview of the Mafia's role in Cuba, see T.J. English's Havana Nocturne. His attention to detail when it comes to the Havana Conference and its fallout is beyond impressive, and it will make implications for the world to come for the mob in the aftermath of the event. For more on American imperialism in Central America, see Walter Lefebvre's Inevitable Revolutions. It focuses on American foreign policy in the Caribbean of the late 19th century, and it goes through the 1980s, noting the political upheavals that resulted from many of these policies that we've been talking about here today. The obvious film reference is The Godfather, what with not only the rooftop scene, but also the nightlife that, of all people, Fredo brings to light. We'll get into that topic in due time, but I also wanted to give you a deep cut and a documentary. El Salvador, Another Vietnam, is a documentary that was produced in the late 1970s. Obviously, it doesn't discuss Cuba, but you'll see parallels between the dictatorial regimes that we've discussed here today with Cuba and those that took shape in El Salvador later in the 20th century. Highly recommend. I hope you enjoyed this episode, everyone. I'm planning another mini-series similar to what we did with Vegas. In the next episode, we'll tour the casinos that the mob built, and we'll meet the mobsters who ran them. But for now, please be sure to rate, subscribe, and review to An Offer You Can't Refuse wherever you get your podcasts. And don't forget to check us out on social media. Our Facebook page is An Offer You Can't Refuse with R.S. Pettengill, and we're also now on TikTok, Instagram, and X. Love to have you chime in on some of the topics that we take up here online. That's all for now, everyone. Let's talk again soon.